This is the VSM Real Estate Podcast. All things real estate, all the time. Hi, and welcome to the VSM Real Estate Podcast. I'm Daniel Krakowski. I'll be your host today. Today we'll be talking about buying your first rental property. And to do this, I'm joined by Allison Rudin.
Hi there.
Goran Vasevich.
Hi, everybody.
And Ryan Schroeder.
Hello.
The reason we brought Allison in, she works at KPS, which is our kind of fraternal company here who does all of our contracting work, property maintenance, that type of stuff. She's also a licensed agent and is looking to purchase her first rental property and is getting a lot of information from Goran, Ryan, myself, and is ready to start moving forward and actually making that purchase. So how's the process been going so far?
So far, so good. A lot of research, but from what I understand, it's just because the first one is the scariest, but I've been pre-approved for up to $170,000 right now. And I just want to get a duplex right now and possibly get a couple more in by the end of 2017.
Nice.
That sounds fantastic. You're on the right track.
Thank you. And what are your long-term goals for investing in real estate?
Well, I want to get probably like 5 investment properties by the end of 2017. In the next couple of years, I hope to get, 10, 15, 20, who knows. I just want to invest and I want to have my money make more money.
Yeah, if it makes dollars, it makes sense.
That's right.
And what are you kind of focusing on right now when you're looking for duplexes? How are you determining what's a good fit for you?
Well, I want to, it's a duplex, and I'll probably be living in one of the sides or upper level, I guess. It's just, I want to live on one side just because I understand that it's an easier down payment with the FHA loan, which we'll probably talk about today. And I just want to live there for a little bit, see how it works, see how the other side works. And from there, I'll probably end up moving somewhere else. But I guess we'll see how that goes.
Ryan, can you tell us a little bit more about the advantages to buying a duplex as your first property with an FHA loan?
Absolutely. So in buying a duplex with usually using FHA financing if you're a first-time home buyer, what that's going to afford you is a very low down payment, as low as 3.5% down. So it allows you to not have to come up with 20 or 25% down like conventional financing would. And the advantage of a duplex is, like Allison alluded to, you can live in one side and rent the other and should be able to cover most, if not all, of your mortgage costs from the one rental unit and effectively live for free, which allows you to save money and fuel your growth even further.
It also allows you sometimes to qualify for a little more as well, because you get to use some of that rental income combined with your earned income for qualifying.
Yes, absolutely. A lot of mortgage companies will allow you to use 75% of the rental income on that other duplex to add to your income for qualification purposes. So perhaps that 170 could swell to 250,000, for example.
Right.
Nice.
Yeah, absolutely. And then when you're looking as well, I think there's always a few important considerations that people are looking at, especially in a place that they're going to live themselves, location.
Yeah, absolutely.
How well it's going to cash flow. I know when I bought my first property, a big consideration that went into it was the fact that my girlfriend was going to live there. So she was very concerned about just how livable the property was as opposed to, how it worked as an investment. We were fortunately able to find some sort of middle ground.
Yeah.
How are you looking at it? Are you looking at it on one end of the spectrum or of the other?
I think I'm more, because of where I live now, I don't have, a ton of room already. So I don't need to have like a lot of space. I just want to have at least 2 bedrooms. Everybody always wants that dream kitchen. I don't care if I can cook, I can cook. That's what matters.
Right.
I would like to have a garage. Again, I always grew up with being able to park in the driveway, so the garage isn't a necessity, but I understood from Goran that it's probably best to get a place with garages for both sides because you could probably get some more money. And then, the location, location, location. You hear it all the time in real estate, and that's what's most important to me. So,
to interject quick here, I understand you have a few questions that you want to ask us, both of Daniel and myself and Ryan. and to get a few different clarifying points on different items. So I kind of want to just, you know, open this up to kind of a Q&A system.
Mm-hmm.
So just go ahead and ask any one of us your first question that you may have.
All right, guys. Is it smarter investment-wise to buy a single-family home or a multi-unit, and why?
Well, it's kind of a tricky question. So a single-family house is more likely to have significant appreciation potential. So for a long-term buy and hold down the road, probably will sell for a higher price. Whereas on multifamily, you get the benefit of a higher cap rate, so more rental income. It really depends on what your investment objective is.
Can I interject for a sec?
Sure.
Can you explain what a cap rate is?
Sure. Cap rate is, it stands for capitalization rate. Very quickly, it's the net operating income of a property divided by the purchase price. So if you made, say for example, $8,000 a year in profit on a property that cost $100,000, that $8,000 divided by $100,000 equals an 8% return or an 8% cap rate. So when you look at any investment, there's usually an inverse relationship between how much money this property is going to cash flow and its upside potential for appreciation. Single family houses are bought and sold typically for emotional reasons. So, how the property looks or what school it is, a district it's in or the location, things of that nature are going to greatly dictate the value and the appreciation. Whereas on a multifamily investment type property, it's all numbers based. So as you increase the rents, so do the values.
That makes sense. Absolutely. That's why I'm going for duplex.
I would agree. I mean, I think if you're starting out, I think that duplexes are the way to go. It gives you a little bit more bang for the buck. It spreads some of your risk around because you have two rental units versus one. And cash flow and cash management is the name of the game, especially as you're starting out. Mm-hmm. Once you've got more money than you know what to do with it, then shooting for appreciation and asset preservation become, you know, different objectives later down the road.
There's also some value, too, for being able to control two, potentially up to four if you're buying a fourplex, units with a 3.5% down payment offered
Absolutely.
To you by the FHA. So, you know, the more units you can acquire on that first purchase, the better off you're going to be in terms of what you're going to put into it versus what you're going to get out of it.
Exactly, especially with the down payment. I mean, that's huge, especially for people like me. So.
Agreed.
And just to add real quick to what Ryan and Daniel said, before you even begin, I think you should determine kind of what your goal is or set
mm-hmm.
a goal when it comes to real estate investment. Whether it's just one property or your goal is to have 100 properties, all that is going to be predetermined before you even start investing in your first property. And I know when I bought my first property, my goal has always been to accumulate as much as possible. So that's the way I looked at it from the beginning. Some people just want to buy, you know, three or four or five and have that be as, you know, part of their investment strategy, like a 401k.
Yeah, I was actually going to go with a single family house until I started meeting and talking to you guys. So I thank you guys for that.
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, in a single family house, sure, you might get a little bit more enjoyment out of it. You're not sharing a wall. You're not sharing your space.
Yeah.
But you're not getting the advantage of somebody else paying your mortgage. So I like to say, you know, suffer a little bit now and reap the benefits later. So.
Exactly. All right. Where do you guys think, and maybe this is just, you know, all depending on who the buyer is, but where do you guys think I should look for a property in regards to like the metro area? Is it St. Paul? Is it outskirts?
Well, if you're going to be going the route of a duplex, you're primarily relegated to the cities. There's not going to be a ton of duplex opportunities in prestigious suburbs, and that's not really the type of area that attracts a lot of duplex type renters. I would say Minneapolis and St. Paul if you go the route of duplex. If you go the route of single family, then you can go really anywhere in the metro. The most important thing, again, like you alluded to earlier, is location, location, location. There's areas like the West 7th neighborhood of St. Paul or Northeast in Minneapolis, Lower Town in St. Paul that are really up and coming and have appreciation rates that are higher than other areas. There's markets like Uptown or South Minneapolis or Downtown Minneapolis that are really well-known, well-established areas that you're going to pay a little bit of a premium to get into. And then there's 1,000 suburbs as well, and they're all good choices. It kind of depends on the which route you want to go as far as duplex or single family.
And when you're going and looking at these places, I think it's extremely important to consistently actually go and check them out. You know, you should always be analyzing deals and always be driving out and taking a look at them, because I think you'll find that once you actually have your feet on the ground out there, you know, you'll be able to find some gems that necessarily you wouldn't see if you were just looking at for photos. For example, in South Minneapolis, I just bought a duplex there that I'm currently living in and doing what you're planning on doing. And not an area that I traditionally would have been looking for as a great investment, but, you know, going out and just taking the chance and being willing to spend, you know, an hour here, an hour there, just gave me that extra bit of insight. And now I like the area so much, I bought the duplex four houses down as well. So, you know, there's just a lot that can be had from actually just getting out there and pounding the pavement and really getting to work on it.
All right. Well, this kind of goes with the what you just said. How do I know if a property is a good deal when I, you know, I'm looking at properties, seeing them? How do I know if it's a good deal?
Well, again, it depends a little bit if you're going the duplex route or the single family route. So I'll kind of answer it from both perspectives. If you are going for a duplex, triplex, fourplex, we call that multifamily, the way that you're going to determine whether or not it's a good deal is by doing an investment analysis. The nuts and bolts of that are adding up what will be the monthly rental income minus all of the expenses, so taxes, insurance, maintenance, mortgage payment, things like that. And if at the end there's a good amount of money left over, like we talked about earlier with the net operating income, that's how you really know if that's one you should be looking at. When it comes to single family, that's a little bit of a different story. You're comparing it to, we call them comps, comparable properties in the area. So if you're looking at a 3-bed, 2-bath, 1,500 square foot house with a 2-car garage, there's generally a good number of properties that fit that same criteria that have sold in the last 6 months. So what I would do is I would look at all of those, compare each one of them to the subject property, and it'll help you to determine, hey, is this a good deal or a bad deal? And really just got to get in there and do the research.
And I think when you have that ability, you know, to really know what you're putting into and plugging into all of those formulas that you're getting, I think what's really important is, number one, to have a great mentor who will show you, you know, what's important, what's not, and to be able to check your numbers for you, basically, you know, grade your homework for you so you know if you're doing it right and if what you're finding actually makes sense. And then also making sure you have a great team around you as well, so you know you can ask questions to for you, for example, I ask you questions about what my, you know, fee's going to be for having some contracting work done and stuff like that as well. So making sure that you have a group of people that you trust and are knowledgeable who can give you relevant information so you can make sure that the numbers that are coming out on the end of whatever formula you're using are going to be accurate ones.
I think just to add, it's important to have the tools handy, and BiggerPockets.com has free tools that you can use for rental calculator or flip calculator, where you can plug in numbers that you already have at a listing that you're looking, which will give you the cap rate that Ryan was talking about or the cash on cash return. So I think that it would be a really good idea for when you find a property that you run the numbers each and every time just to get the practice at first and to see what those numbers actually look like and how you come to those numbers. So.
And we will be looking at doing a cap rate, cash on cash return podcast in the future that will be assisted with some slideshows, because it's one of those things that's a little bit more helpful to visualize as well.
For sure, yeah. It's going to be more in-depth, and we'll maybe even do a video. I think it would be worth a lot. But again, utilize some tools that we have internally within VSM or ones that are available for free online to determine if a property really is a good value or a value that you're looking to get as far as a return goes, whether it be 5 cap, 10 cap, 15 cap.
Okay.
Yeah, and Bigger Pocket, just going back to that really quickly and talking about analyzed deals, I think their big thing that they always stress is analyze three deals every day when you're looking for a property, especially when you're starting out, because it's going to give you that ability to quickly recognize when you just look at, you know, a few numbers on the MLS or Zillow or wherever it is, to be like, this is a deal. This is something I need to get in.
Great advice.
It is true. I mean, if you analyze three properties and one comes out at a 7.4, the other comes out at a 7.3, and then one pops out as an 8.1% cap rate, you know that this one's a 10% better deal than the other ones, and it'll become more evident. So.
Yeah, I've been trying to work on that. I actually like looking at all that stuff now. So that kind of also leads into the next question as well. Where should I even go? I mean, I know I have the MLS access, but if somebody doesn't have that, where should they
go? Where do we find the deals?
Yeah, how do they find the good ones?
Well, you know, obviously I'm going to be biased on that, but I think that, you know, an agent with VSM Real Estate is going to be your best bet, because we are investment specialists. We do this day in and day out. So any of the agents here are trained to find these deals, analyze them. They can give you an idea of what it would cost to rehab them, what it will rent for, help you to project all of those financial calculations that we discussed earlier, as well as have the contacts for the lending, the title, the insurance, and of course the construction piece, which is all very important, you know, getting you through the leasing process and the ongoing management. So,
and all of those contacts too are like the best practices. We've been burned probably at some point on all of those from somebody. So now the people that we're working with are people that have consistently done a good job.
Yeah, exactly. So we can take a lot of the guesswork out of the equation just by having the right team around you. So.
Yeah, so MLS, Zillow, Craigslist, call other management companies and see if they have any owners who are looking to sell. Ask us if we have any owners or landlords who are looking to sell their property. Those are going to be your off-market deals. Reach out to wholesalers. I get 5 to 10 emails a day from wholesalers looking to own properties that are off MLS. Pretty much anything and everything is open game all the time. No one thing is going to work the time. A lot of times we'll hear people say, well, if it's on MLS, you know, it's not a deal. And that's really not true, because the last deal that we actually did today, the 420 View, I found on the MLS, and it was a good investment from a numbers perspective. So, and I found deals on Craigslist.
Zillow, word of mouth, referrals. There's no silver bullet.
Everywhere.
You have to just always be looking.
Everywhere.
It becomes part of your lifestyle.
Exactly.
Nice. All right, a lot of people I know that, you know, they've always thought yes, no, yes, no, yes, no when buying an investment property. They're scared about the money that they have right away. I don't have a lot of money, but is it possible to have a small amount of money and still get an investment property?
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. And especially when you're a licensed real estate agent like you are, you're getting a commission for buying that property. But even still, your down payment of 3.5%, you know, even on $200,000, that's $7,000. You're typically going to ask the seller to pay your closing costs. And if you buy something that's turnkey, you're into two rental units for, you know, say $7,000. It might be a little bit difficult to come up with that, but you're talking about a major step forward in your financial freedom. If you're cash flowing, say, $500 a month on that, it will only take you a year to get that initial investment back, not to mention the appreciation and the equity you would have achieved at the same time.
There's also a ton of value in just getting creative with the way that you start financing things. Besides just normally getting an FHA loan and buying it yourself, you know, if you're having trouble scraping that cash together and you're already out there, you're looking for deals, you're talking to investors. I know a lot of investors who, if you're willing to let them into half of a property and they only bring forward, you know, a 3.5% down payment, they might be very, very interested in figuring out some way to work that out with you as well. So, you know, who you know can also be a big benefit, and that just goes back to exactly what we're doing, looking for deals. We can also use that to look for ways to finance our deals too.
Yeah, and Gorn and I have purchased properties in the past on contract for deed with zero money down before too. So where there's a will, there's a way. You just gotta always be out there shaking the trees and seeing what comes, you know, what comes out of it.
And when you were talking a little bit earlier, you said turnkey. I understand what those mean now, but I think a lot of people don't know what that means. What is turnkey and a value add?
So yeah, we typically will divide properties into two categories. Turnkey means that the day that you buy it and the seller turns the keys over to you, that this property is good to go. It doesn't need anything. It's not going to need cosmetic updates, you know, any structural or electrical type repairs. You could probably pass a rental license inspection the next day and have a tenant in there. Now, value add means that you're buying something that's in distress. It could be a hoarder situation, could be just 40 years of no updates, whatever it is, but you're going to have to go in there and do a lot of work in order to get the property up to a condition that would be, you know, desirable to a tenant. So the reason we call that value add is because we're creating equity and creating value in that property by doing the work ourselves. So if you're ever going to buy a property that needs work, you need to buy it for below its market value to have that make sense. Otherwise, you're doing the work but not really getting paid for your time. So, but if you're in a position like you are where cash is the greatest limiting factor, you don't have a lot of extra money beyond the down payment to put into the property, you're pretty much reduced to looking for turnkey or near turnkey properties.
Yeah.
That's a good point. Know what you're capable of or what your capabilities are. A lot of people want to go into a distressed property without having, you know, $20,000, $40,000 to actually fix it and then rent it. So a lot of times turnkey is the best solution, and we buy those as well as distressed properties or value add properties. It really just depends. And the bottom line is always going to be, if it makes dollars, it's going to make sense. Mm-hmm. So I would not kind of disregard any of the properties if it's a turnkey or if it's a value add.
And it's not to say that you can't do a value add proposition on your first deal. There is FHA rehab financing. It's just a little bit more of an undertaking. Effectively, let's say the house is worth $150,000 in its current condition, and if you stuck $30,000 in improvements in it, it might be appraised for $200,000 when it's all said and done. You can try and get a loan to cover both the cost of acquisition and of the rehab. Again, it's just a little bit more advanced than your typical first-time buyer would do. Not to say that we're scared of it or that we couldn't help you with it. Certainly with your experience in the construction business, it might be more viable for you than the average person.
Yeah, I mean, if you can just buy one that's turnkey, move on to the next, that would be my advice if I were you, just to keep things moving along.
Yeah.
You don't want to spend 6 months turning a property to make the money that you could have made 6 months prior with a turnkey property. So to me and to you and to everybody else, the time is going to be the most valuable asset in that aspect of things. So that's the way I look at things.
Yeah,
just as an example too, for my first property, I was into it, all things said and done, you know, through some creative financing, getting a rebate back for myself, about $2,000 or $3,000 for a $250,000 property. My second property, I spent about 15 times that amount on the rehab. So, you know, that's
limiting.
Are you
getting 15 times amount of the returns?
I'm not.
Exactly.
Right? So.
Yeah, that's why it really comes down to, you know, cash is king in this business. So to the extent that you can use FHA financing, 3.5% down, the golden ticket for you would be a 2-4 unit multifamily that's pretty turnkey, where you can use the rental income from the other units to help you qualify, bite this thing off, and, you know, have very little of your own money into it.
Okay. Let's see. So say that I buy a turnkey property. I know that it's probably, or close to a turnkey, I should say. What should I focus on in order to make the rented, the unit next to me that I'm not going to live in, what should I focus on in order to make that rent ready?
Well, we like to say renting is a beauty contest. So everything is going to be based on the way this property looks. The tenants aren't going to concern themselves with whether or not you have a new roof or a new furnace. They're going to care about the way, how clean it is, how does the paint look, how's the carpet and the flooring, things of that nature. So worry about making it pretty. Don't overspend for the area. Like if you have a $1,000 a month property, you know, you don't need to put in granite countertops. But if you're going to have a $3,000 a month property, then the expectation is to have granite or quartz type countertops. So it's somewhat commensurate, the level of improvements to the value of the rental in the area in which you're in.
I just want to say that Ryan thinks everything's a beauty contest, including walking down the street. But
it's a beauty contest.
Yeah, exactly. I digress. The other thing too is you know, really picking and choosing how much you're going to put into each unit. I've put no money into the unit that I'm living in yet.
Yeah.
I'm currently taking all that money and putting it into buying the next property and then the property after that. So, you know, as much as you can live humbly, the further you'll be able to stretch your money into something that will continue to grow and make
yeah.
you more money.
Just to add, I mean, life is a competition. There's a lot of tenants out there. Yes, that's true. But also there's going to be a lot of investors who are looking to rent to those tenants. So if I have a house next to yours and I'm renting, you're my competition. So I can do anything and everything to beat that competition. So as a new landlord and existing landlord, you just have to be aware that there's competition and you have to stand out and you have to make your property desirable. Doing the bare minimum does not work in this market. Or if you do the bare minimum, you're going to attract the type of tenant that you don't want, which is going to cost you way more money in the long run. So
yeah.
I would consider it as a competition to make it as good as possible. Not trying to, you know, save a couple pennies. They're going to cost you way more money down the line. So that's
right. The grade A tenants, like we kind of refer to them
yeah.
as, they're sophisticated. They know that they have options. They have the credit and the income to qualify for anywhere they want to go. So they're going to seek a good looking property in a good area for a good value. So making sure that you've priced it right and done the right improvements, all that's very important.
Don't get the cheapest paint. Don't get the cheapest floors. Don't get all of those things will, you know, get you a certain type of clientele or a tenant in this case. So if you set the right precedents from the beginning, that's going to be a game changer for you. It's going to be a less headache in the future, which is what you want in order to grow your portfolio from 1 to 101.
And I think buying a duplex first really helps, you know, exemplify that, because you're living in one side, this person's living in the other. You can kind of think about where you're at in your life right now, you know, what your interests are, what your hobbies are, what your income's like, and you're happy living in one of these units. Well, you have to assume the person living in the other unit is a similar type person, right? So you can very easily look at the unit and say, well, what would I need to want to live in this? And if it doesn't meet that criteria, you're not going to get that type of tenant, and you're going to have issues with it. And then moving forward, you can kind of always use that as your guideline and say, well, this is a bigger property. This is, you know, I need to do more than I did at this other one to bring it up to the level that the property deserves.
That makes sense. So I know that some city, and I understand this side, but some cities have rental license requirements. Some people might not know what that is or what it's about. Can you guys explain that?
Sure. Yeah, there's a lot of cities in the Twin Cities that will have a rental license requirement. Effectively, the city wants to make sure that the property is safe and in livable condition. So they're going to look for things like, you know, loose handrails, exposed electrical wires. They're going to look for, you know, broken steps, things of that nature. They're not typically going to be looking for, okay, well, this should really be painted tan, or you should really
yeah.
put stainless steel appliances in here. It's really more the structural safety type of things, so that the tenants are being protected, so that they're not subjected to slumlord type tactics.
Okay.
My recommendation?
Yeah.
Hire a management company, a professional one at that. So VSM, you know, is in the business of managing properties, so I would definitely recommend that you let us and our personnel handle those. Having the right, you know, compliance codes and right licenses and making sure the city approves the property is going to be crucial, because if you can't rent it, you can go months on end without having any rental income.
What I always say is I work at a property management company. I'm around it all the time. I take on new business and get them ready, you know, send them, you know, educate them about the rental license requirements. I still don't really know how to do it, because it's not worth it to me. The amount of time that I would spend having to learn how to do it, I'd much rather pay the people who work here who do it all the time to just take care of it for me.
Yeah, and I'm not saying that because, you know, hey, we want to get all the business. I'm just saying that in order for you to have a successful experience so you can go on to other things, you know, your day job and getting more properties, you want to focus on the management, the day-to-day management of your property. You want to focus on your portfolio growth. So you want to be looking for other properties and other opportunities. How are you going to do that if you have to do day-to-day management? You won't be able to. The time will not be there. That's, you know, the reason why you want to hire somebody.
Right, somebody who has both the time and the skill to do it better than you could is worth the fee.
I always look at it in terms of painting too, where if I'm hiring someone to paint my property, I'm like, well, if I'm paying them, you know, $40 an hour, say, to paint the property, would I get a part-time job painting for $40 an hour? Probably not. You know, I value my free time and everything else. I'd much rather just have them do it for that rate, right? Because it doesn't matter which way it's going. It still ends up being the same net to me, whether or not I'm doing it or they're doing it.
Especially if you consider it take you twice as long, so you'd really be making $20 an hour.
Right, exactly.
We've seen people just do it themselves just to get the feel for it and, you know, figure out if that's what they want to do or not want to do. And more times, they figure out, like, hey, this is not what I want to do.
Yeah,
every single day.
It's not to say that as a landlord you might not occasionally get called into an emergency type situation to handle things. I can definitely think of times where Gorn and I have had to go in there and clean and turn a property and paint it ourselves. But generally speaking, we value our time and our expertise at a dollar value that's higher than what it costs us to pay a tradesman for most things, and so we just hire it out.
And kind of to go back to your previous question about, you know, the condition and what you should do to property and starting off on the right foot, making sure the property is tip-top from the get-go so you won't get those phone calls, you won't have those issues. That is going to be your number one priority. That is always for us as well, to make sure that we start the property in the right condition with the right tenant.
Okay. Great. Yeah, so my next question was actually going to be the pros and cons of getting a property management company. What are the cons of getting a property management company?
Cost money.
Yeah, obviously. So it's the money factor. So.
Yeah, I mean, it's the same thing as, you know, you could change your oil yourself, but, you know, you got to get your hands dirty and you got to take the time to do it. So the same thing with property management. Do you want to get your hands dirty and you want to take the time away from your either your job or your free time? And that's a question that each person needs to answer on their own.
Do you want to take the time to collect the rent? Do you want to take the time to answer phone calls, emails, go over there, do your own painting, maintenance, or whatnot? And if the answer is yes, because that's what you want to do, then more power to you. It's all good. But I can tell you the fact, I had one property for 3 years, and I did everything myself. And within that time, I wasn't able to look for other properties. The minute I made a conscious decision, I was like, listen, I want to grow my portfolio, and I have to get away from doing day-to-day management. I have to hire somebody. I have to get more people involved. So the minute I did that, my portfolio grew exponentially, and it's been, you know, that way for many years now.
I have property management for the other unit of the duplex that I live in, and I don't get any discount unless you guys want to give me one.
Nope.
Okay, it was worth a shot. I thought I'd take it in the public forum. But it's totally worth it just for keeping the tenant at an arm's length and knowing that everything goes through them. It's just an extra layer of protection for you as an owner as well.
Plus, do you want to have just three properties?
No.
Okay, so
I think that Daniel touched on a really good point there too, especially if you're going to be living in if it's going to be a duplex or a triplex, you're going to be living in it. Being able to remain arm's length from the transaction has a lot of value. You know, you don't want to get buddy-buddy with this person, and then when they fall on hard times, now all of a sudden you've got to break them for the rent and you feel bad about it. You know, keep it business, keep it arm's length, you know, stay removed. You might even tell the tenant on the other side that you're a tenant too. Don't even let them know you're the owner and just stay fully removed.
Yeah, I've learned that from my day-to-day job.
I definitely recommend it. Like I said, there's going to be pros and cons. Yeah, it's going to cost you money.
That's the only con, really.
Well, I'm already spending money, so
who
cares?
You're spending money
exactly.
to make more money.
Exactly.
Okay?
That's what this is all about. There's bad tenants out there, and I don't want to get an investment property where they're going to just trash it. So how do I go about finding a qualified tenant?
Physical threats. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, since Daniel is our acquisitions manager, and he goes to people's homes on a daily basis to talk about real estate management, I want to hear what he has to say.
Oh, just putting me on the spot here, huh?
That's right.
All
right.
So I think the first part and the first consideration that you want to take in is looking at areas that are going to make good investments for you. So we're looking at areas that are going to be appreciating quickly. And that's, you know, just something that you want to make sure that you're taking into account. Beyond that, really what we've touched on a little bit before too about making sure your property is in the condition that you want it to be and would expect it to be for the price range that you're asking is extremely important as well. The type of tenant who expects to get their full security deposit back tends to have a lot of options in the rental world, so you want to make sure you're appealing to them. On top of that, you also want to make sure that you have a great screening process at your property management company, or if you're doing it yourself, you want to make sure that you're doing some due diligence as well. The general criteria that we use for screening our tenants is having a credit score above 600, having no felonies, evictions, unlawful detainers, anything like that on their record. Having a good, clean rental history is extremely important as well. So when we are checking for our tenants' rental history, we contact all of their previous landlords, and their application isn't complete until we heard back.
Oh,
so
good.
if they're ignoring us, we're just going to keep bothering them until the tenant applicant to keep bothering them too until we get what we want. So we're not leaving any gaps in there or any surprises in their history. And then the final component is their income. We're looking for 3 times the monthly rent and income. And
nice.
By doing it this way, we've managed to have an eviction rate of tenants that we've placed of better than 1 in 1,000.
Wow. I didn't know that.
Yeah. And one thing, you know, I can even paraphrase it even a little bit more. I like to target hipster type areas. I like to attract the young urban professional type that chooses to rent. People, Gen Yers, Gen X, even some of the millennials. People who choose to rent because it's a lifestyle choice, not people who are necessarily just forced to rent.
Yeah, because they can't buy.
Mm-hmm.
All right. What are some common mistakes or pitfalls that people do and learn from when buying their first investment property?
I think it has a lot to do with cash management. If you get into a property where you use every penny you have on the down payment and then you get into it and now you need $10,000, $20,000 worth of improvements and you don't have it, you need to have a real good idea of what it's going to cost you both to get into it and to get this thing into rent-ready condition before you get it rented out. Making sure that you have the right insurance. If you are living there, the insurance is different than if you're going to be renting it, making sure you're protecting yourself there. I typically recommend that you hold your property in an LLC. A limited liability company will segregate this asset from yourself personally, provide you some protection there. And
and from your current property that you have, because you have a property already that you own, so.
Right, and then I would say the last pitfall is, again, not to be arrogant, but a lot of people think that they can do it on their own and they don't need any help and they're just going to learn the hard way. Whereas if you just go ahead and pick a quality management company who has already been through these things, they can save you. The fees that they charge will be more than made up for in terms of limiting your vacancy, getting you additional rent, dealing with headaches and issues. So.
Yeah, there's no prize for learning things hard way. And that's a lot of, you know, the reason why people pay us to manage their properties is because we know what we're doing and we've been through it. So a lot of the pitfalls they want to avoid, they choose us to avoid for them.
And I think before we look at the management, I think it's super important to look at how you procure the property in the first place. Because I think that's, you know, what you're paying for it and what you're getting is essentially, you know, the scaffolding which you're going to build this investment around. And I think a lot of times people get put on a bad path. I'd say probably about 15 to 25% of the properties that I bring on from people who bought them as solely an investment are someone who has a friend who's a real estate agent who was like, hey man, this is going to be a good investment. I think you should pick this up. For real though, it's crazy. And then I run the numbers on it for, you know, and you don't even really have to at this point, but oftentimes I do to show them what to expect moving forward. And in an optimal situation for what they have, they're losing money every year because the person who gave them advice didn't give them the correct advice and never learn themselves. So when you're looking for an agent and you're looking to buy a property, you need to ask them these questions and make sure that they really understand investment property and how to analyze a deal.
Which is another thing that VSM brings to the table. When you are doing your calculations, 99% of the time, you're going to miss things that we know should be on that balance sheet.
Yeah.
The cost of management, the vacancy rate, which is, we set at 5%, as you know, most people don't have that figure in there. They think that the property is going to be fully occupied 100% of the time, all the time.
Yeah, and it's not as simple as what's the rent and what's the mortgage. There's more to
it. Never
is.
Never is.
You need to have projections for replacement reserves and repairs, and you have to know that your insurance is going to be higher on a rental than in a typical. Your property taxes are going to go up when this
association fees.
Status.
That's the killer. No one
hates association fees.
Taxes, they're going up. Utilities that you have to pay that the tenant will not be paying. I mean, and he mentioned cash management. Ryan mentioned cash management. So to me, I think time management is also going to be your key or your pitfall that most people go into, because you're going to go in that cycle where, just like me, for 3 years, I didn't buy an additional property because I was just consumed by my one. My time management was horrible until I actually decided to just free myself of the time wasters so I can focus on, you know, growing my portfolio. That's really what a lot of people, everyone wants to save money, not thinking about the time. And the time or the money that you do save, it's nothing compared to what you could have made had you had that time back.
Absolutely.
So.
All right, I think this is my last one. And I'm not going to do it, but I want to put it out there for other people who might think about doing it. What are the types of consequences?
What are you going to ask us?
What are the types of consequences that there could be if people just cut corners and wing it in regards to buying investment property?
We've seen it all. We've seen properties where the owner has been unwilling to spend, let's say, $1,000 to repaint the main floor. They just want us to rent it as is. Well, then it sits there for 3 or 4 months, and they missed out on $1,500 a month in rent for 3 months, and then eventually they just come around to doing the painting anyways, but it took them, you know, 3 months of vacancy to learn that lesson. So listening to the advice of people who've done it and, you know, reading books, reading articles and things, immersing yourself in the knowledge piece of it, I think that's really important. Don't think that you know it all on your first deal. Look to other people who've done it.
Yeah, and the as-is should be just taken out if you're listing your rental property, like, out of the equation. You should never rent as is or have it in your mind that tenants are going to make those improvements.
Yeah.
We've seen, I can think of a particular instance, one of the first properties that we ever took on, the tenants had moved in and they filed a maintenance request saying that the door to the garage was really sticky and difficult to open. And I told the owner, okay, well, we'll need to get this fixed. And he said, oh, well, we lived with that for 4 years when we lived in this house. And I said, well, the standards are changed now. If it's not easy for someone to open a door and they don't feel like they can secure a door to the outside, I mean, that's a problem. You just need to get it out of your mind as is.
You're delivering
a
bad product. And that's one thing that I forgot to mention is when you are going into the venture, buying your first rental, you know, property, or buying, you know, 1 to 10, whatever, you have to treat it as a business. You just have to. That's the only way it's going to make financial sense, and you're going to be making decisions based on that kind of perspective where you're delivering a product. Do you want to deliver a product in, you know, crappy shape with broken windows, doors, screens, and unpainted? Or do you want to deliver it in really good shape that, you know, it's going to demand higher rent, better tenants? So you have to treat it as a business because it is a business.
Right.
You know, you're going to be producing X amount of dollars per year, per month, whatever. So,
and as much as they may pay you, you're going to spend the money and the time to fix the unit you're not living in first. I mean, that's the one that you have to attract the public to. And then as you, you know, refill your cash coffers, then you'll go back and do the other unit that you live in just prior to you moving out.
Exactly.
So.
And the independent, I think the type of person who buys rental properties tends to be someone who's, you know, very strong-willed, independent, entrepreneurial, So they tend to not want to listen to a lot of outside advice.
100% agree. Yeah.
And I think, you know, just going into it and approaching it the way that you are right now of keeping an open mind and being willing to, you know, try and do the things that are going to, you know, potentially give you the best return, and taking our advice, taking other people's advice that you continue to meet out there, is going to be one of the best ways to make sure that you're continually being successful and not, you know, trying to cut corners and do these other things as well.
Exactly. Well, I mean, I appreciate you guys. Every time I have a question, you guys are there to answer. And like I even said earlier, I was going into all of this just a couple months ago. I talked to you, Ryan, about probably getting a property, and I didn't want to do the duplex. There was like no way I was going to do a duplex, move in there. And just after all the research and talking to you guys, talking to the lender, it's
a
smart way to do it.
I lived northeast Minneapolis, did a duplex, bought a duplex, live in one unit or downstairs and rented the upstairs.
Yeah.
I did it, and it was great.
Right, and it's a matter of what your goal is. If your goal is to build a real estate investment portfolio, there's going to be some sacrifices that need to be made, including saving your money to buy it. You know, if getting rich were easy, everybody would be doing it.
Exactly.
So I think it would be a good follow-up podcast for when you do make your purchase to tell everyone what you bought,
sure.
Some of the figures and stats, what you did, and if you decide to go with professional management or if you decide to go with just managing property yourself. So that's something that we're going to follow up on.
Okay.
And we're going to pin that down. Hopefully within the next 45 days we'll have that ready.
Awesome. Well, I think that was a great podcast. Thanks for coming in, Allison.
No problem. Thank you, guys.
Have a great week, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks.